Hello and welcome to the second annual Doctor Who Halloween Spooktacular, now officially hosted by Security Kitchen Productions. This year, we're also missing one of our guests. Just like last year.
Except I'm the replacement now.
No, last year Brian was missing and it was me, you, and Dylan, Jake.
Oh, right.
This year we're missing Dylan and we have Brian and, and Jacob here.
So basically off-brand Lord Slar has joined you for this one.
Okay.
That's what I'm calling myself now.
You are not off-brand Lord Slar.
I'm changing the Diet Lord Slar, whatever. I'm changing the YouTube channel and everything.
Sure. Anyway, alright, so today we're talking about some spooky Doctor Who stories. Today we're talking about the Daemons, Horror Fang Rock, and the Empty Child / the Doctor Dances. Have I talked about any of these other than Empty Child before on my channel? I don't think so.
Not on your channel. I know I've talked about Daemons on the greatest podcast in the galaxy, if that still exists.
I think it does. I forget if the videos are still up.
I don't know. They might be.
I don't know. Anyway, so we're talking about these stories today. Of course, spoilers, and let's, I guess, jump right into this. So, start off with The Daemons by Robert Sloman, right?
It's Robert Sloman and Barry Letts.
Is it credited as Robert Sloman and Barry Letts?
It's credited as Guy Leopold.
That's it. Okay. I knew there was something tricky with it. Anyway, yeah, so here we go. The Daemons, and yes, it is Daemons, not demons, not how else do people say it? I know, like, there's this big argument about the pronunciation of it. And I'm just like, look, they say it in the damn episode. Anyway, so let's get right into this.
The
so
Daemons Brian, from the planet Deimos.
And Brian, for some reason, doesn't fucking like this story. So you want to start us off, Brian?
Brian doesn't like this one.
Do that right away then. All right, let's get into it. Why not?
Go ahead.
I am not a fan of this story. At this point, it just feels like another real overdrawn, bog standard monster story, like the Daemons themselves. Like, they're an interesting concept and I think they could work well, but I don't think they're executed properly. No.
What about the Daemons isn't executed?
I don't like the woman. She gets on my nerves a lot, and she's like a central part of the plot.
Oh, I like her a lot.
The whole force barrier thing is stupid, and I don't understand. It's only there to draw it out even more, and I'm just like, please end my pain and suffering by episode 5.
The story drags a little bit, and I do agree it kind of does, but not really. Even then, like, I'm not, like, desiring death by the end of it. It's just like, oh, okay, well, it's gone on a bit long. You know, probably could have been four parts,
the master,
but whatever.
It's one thing to have, like, master play second fiddle to a monster, but, like, the thing is, there are very few occasions where the master works on his own, and this is not one of them. He's basically on his own for most of this story, and honestly, I just can't fucking stand it.
This is one of my favorite Delgado performances. I think he's so conniving in this one, and also, like, I love the disguise of him pretending to be a priest. It's one of my favorite master disguises. He just really sells it. And also, back to what you were saying about the Daemons and just the general feel of the story, I like the cult attitude of it, you know, to tell this sort of, I mean, what is essentially just, like, a basic... basic cult story, and to include these Doctor Who elements, have the Doctor act as the sort of figure of authority on the scientific side of it, and also have the Master involved in a way. What's up?
But if you want a good, like, cult story, like satanic cult story, it's been done better elsewhere in Doctor Who. Like, K-9 and Company is a piece of 80s cheese, but, oh... The cult thing is done way better than
no.
I disagree, Brian.
I'm gonna strong disagree. Like, yeah, I thought you were about to bring up, like, a really good example of a good cult Doctor Who story, and you're like, you see in K-9 and Company.
Or let's think of another one. Image of the Fendal.
That I could see. But even then, each of these cult stories is missing one key element, and that is the master's involvement, which I adore so much.
Also, let's be honest. Roger Delgado as Mr. Magister is so good.
Yeah.
I love sort of the science versus magic. We're doing a Clark's Law type thing. The first episode in particular is dripping with this gothic atmosphere.
Like the first episode's fine. That's the other four parts that I take issue with. Like, but here's the thing: I really want to like this story. That's the
Brian.
Thing.
Brian, have you seen The Wicker Man?
No.
See, that might be your problem because it's not.
I wanted to like this story so much, I actually went through the trouble of listening to the adaptation for the Target books.
No, it's gonna make.
And that couldn't even.
Okay, Brian, here's the thing. People go into the story who don't like it. They're expecting a gothic horror. Outside of the first episode, this isn't a gothic horror. It's that more Wicker Man pastoral horror.
Yeah.
Like, it's equally as effective because you have the whole. You have this whole, like, it's steeped in a lot of Irish mythology with the sort of Queen of the May stuff.
It's a very different type of horror because when Doctor Who tackles the sort of Hammer horror attitude, it does it in a very traditional Hammer horror way. When this uses other media references, but it uses it in a more literal sense, and I shouldn't say literal sense, in a literary sense, that's what I should have said. And it plays on more traditional folklore and takes it in a new and interesting direction, I think. And now also, keep in mind, this is one of the first horror cultish Doctor Who stories of just ever. Really, the Tom Baker era would popularize this kind of storytelling. And there are times when it's done significantly better, but as a first outing, I think it's very significant and very effective at what it does.
I just think it's, to use a British colloquialism, a bit naff. I'm not a fan.
So, okay, so I also want to talk about the Doctor's role in this story, as the story not so subtly tackles the sort of science versus religion argument, and the Doctor takes a very authoritative stance on this, but also the Doctor encounters some resistance in the area, and that's where I think the supporting characters really shine in this story. Any thoughts on that?
I think it's one of John Pertwee's best performances.
I think so too. You can tell he's really into this script. And also it's a story where where John Pertwee himself really agrees with the Doctor's ideals.
Yeah, and I think it's really, really... I think it works well.
Actually, I should talk about this. This ties back into my opinion, too. Like, I really do like the science versus religion debate when it's explored in, sci-fi. I think that's a really cool, neat concept. I really love it. It's just... The thing about this story is... The story has a lot of stuff I like in it, but it's not at the forefront of the story, you know?
I think it's a very large theme.
Most of it is way too focused on what the Master's doing and what his ultimate plan is, rather than answering these questions that we might have about this. And that... I just feel like there are concepts here that would have been done... That could have been done so much better.
I disagree. I think yeah, it drags near the end, and I mean there's a cliffhanger where it's like we're supposed to be to bring us back next week, it's the Master's in danger.
Yeah.
Which I don't particularly like. But I love the atmosphere. One, I love also how it really plays off of the UNIT family, and I think it's like the last time we really do get to play off the entire UNIT family that well.
Yeah, I think they are very well utilized. And of course, you know, this brings out some favorite UNIT moments.
Chap with the wings there, five rounds rapid.
Yeah, that's actually also worth bringing up. Nick Courtney's really into this script as well.
It's also just such a quotable story. Fancy a dance, Brigadier.
Yeah, yeah, I love that moment at the end. Actually, the ending is quite nice too. I like the lighter nature the ending takes on. How do we feel about this?
I have a big issue with the third Doc story. He is an utter cock to... Like, what the hell did she do to you today? Jesus fucking Christ. Holy shit, bro. Why?
He's so mean to her. Wait, do you have any specific examples? Because I don't...
The entire goddamn story.
Well, he's just putting
her down, being like, oh, don't be such an idiot. Jove, you are really a stupid girl. It's like, holy shit. I could understand.
He doesn't really treat her any differently than he does in any other story.
It feels, honestly, in this story, it feels a bit more playful.
I don't think so at all. Like, even in Terror of the Autons, yeah, it would make sense that way, because, you know, it's the first time they've met. But here it's like, you know this type of thing people talk about. They talk about Colin Baker being the level of dickishness I feel like Pertwee has in this one. Like, holy shit.
I mean, no, I don't see it as really malicious. I agree with Jacob. Like, it does seem a bit more playful to me. I don't know if anyone agrees with that. Anyway, so what else? Oh yeah, Azal. I wanted to bring up any thoughts on Azal, because I do love. I love Stephen Thorne's performance.
Honestly, of the three shouty Stephen Thorne villains, I'm gonna say Azal's kind of the weakest.
I'm gonna agree with that.
I prefer Omega and Eldrad, even though Eldrad is also not the best.
I love him as Eldrad, but I don't know. I think I agree with that that's the weakest, but also Stephen Thorne hasn't really given a bad performance, I think.
For Stephen Thorne.
What?
That's because he plays a Melker in Guardians of Prophecy. He's really good in Guardians of Prophecy.
Oh, cool.
Oh, right. He has done... He did a lot of... Also, RIP both Stephen Thorne and...
Hey, I was gonna bring that up, actually. I guess we can dedicate this sort of to Stephen Thorne, and of course, man, we'll be talking about it in a little bit, Terrence Dix. Both sadly left us recently. Anyway. Go on.
Stories that I don't particularly like. But
everyone cancel Briarheart 02.
For like the third time.
Yeah. Anyway. All right, so ratings out of 10 for the Daemons. Jacob?
Probably an 8.5.
I'll give it a 8, but a bit less generous. I'll give it like 8, like 7.5, possibly. Brian?
Because I'm feeling generous, I will give it a 6.
Okay, what if you weren't feeling generous?
If I wasn't feeling generous, it would probably be a 5.
Huh, interesting. I feel like Daemons is also like one of those stories I could always have a really good time with.
I don't think it's like some people say it's the best of the Pertwee era.
I'd strongly disagree with that. As far as it stands as a Halloween story, it's one of those ones that I can just easily pop in and sit down on a dark and stormy night. Like it fits the atmosphere well, and thus why it's chosen for this video. All right, let's move on to Horror of Fang Rock by Terrence Dix. Brian, I want you to start on this one as well.
I'm just looking like a massive dick in these videos. Like, I promise, guys, honestly, I do love Stephen Thorne, and I do love Terrence Dix a lot. I really don't like Horror of Fang Rock.
Like, a lot? Or are you just, like, exaggerating? Like,
I'm exaggerating a little bit. It honestly, on my list of bad stories, it's not like... I'm just kind of like, it's not, I don't think it's my thing. It feels very mute in comparison to what the Philip Hinchcliffe era was, which obviously it's under a new producer, so of course it is, but it's just kind of like, I don't know. I feel like
it's still a Hinchcliffe-era script given to Graham Williams. He had very little to do with it.
Exactly.
He had very little to do with it. It's basically a Hinchcliffe story.
Well, in that case, either way, it still falls flat for me. It's a flop. I'm sorry. I don't like... None of the characters are enjoyable, dude. And that's like, I feel like that's a big thing that this story needs. It needs to have enjoyable characters to be killed off. But because all of them are dicks, there's no real sense of danger. Because by the end of it, I'm kind of glad that all these people are dead because they're just annoying.
I think. Also, it's worth noting, Brian, you're cutting out a little bit as you continue to talk, so I don't know if you need to have anything to fix. Anyway, I don't agree with you, but I will agree on a couple of points. First off, yeah, I'm not really attached to the characters, but I do think as Terrence Dix didn't really write them as characters, so to speak. Like he just wrote caricatures, I think. I don't think we're really supposed to be attached to them, and the story as a whole is more about the setting and the atmosphere. And also, it's worth noting that Terrence Dix from the outset wasn't terribly invested in writing this story. I don't
exactly.
know
exactly. I'm pretty sure he even said in like one of the commentaries I watched with him recently, he doesn't really like horror Fang Rock. So Terrence Dix agrees with me.
No. He still likes it. He just wasn't invested in writing the script from the outset. Robert Holmes commissioned it from him as revenge for him forcing Robert Holmes to write the Time Warrior.
Oh yeah, that's right. But either way, he still wasn't into it. And like I think I was watching the State of Decay commentary. He was like, yeah, kind of not a fun relationship.
Can I be the completely contrarian and say this is Terrence Dix's best work?
No.
What? I'm gonna hard disagree with that.
What do you think is his best story then? What's his best story?
Best story for me, I mean, realistically, his best story is the War Games. I have a bit more of a soft spot for the Five Doctors. That and also I really like Robot. Anyone who doesn't like Robot is just wrong. Brian. I'm a big fan of State of Decay too. Brain of Morbius is fine, and so is the story. But yeah, it's not his best work. Come on, Jacob.
I think it is. I think this is a 10 out of 10. It is a really good horror story, and it ends with everyone dead. Like it's just this creepy ending that just sort of sits with you, and you sort of sit really unsettled.
See, I wouldn't even say that because.
I also just love what Terrence Dix does with Leela. She's there to be sort of just that. She's genuinely like her best characterization outside of I think season 14 is in this story. Because
I'll agree with that, actually. Yeah,
her interaction with Adelaide is just like she does not take any of Adelaide's early 20th century woman hysterics. Like, it's something like that. I think just is done really well.
Okay, but also like I'm gonna do this to you. The Rudin in this is really shit.
It's not the best effect, but I think it overcomes the. Effect if we're being honest.
I do disagree with that
because for me like if we're the story isn't like up to a good standard to begin with, so why would I be forgiving at all for the shit effect of the Rootin?
I'm forgiving of the effect. I just don't think it's a big threat once it's actually there. Sorry about the train.
Yeah,
sorry about that. Go on.
I love the atmosphere. I love so Tom Baker is
That is one thing I'm really gonna just agree with you on is the atmosphere.
Tom Baker is so moody, and it's just it fills you with this sense of dread, like, ooh, this is a story where you feel like, ah, things are creeping by, and I just think it does such a good job at that.
I will give it this. I do really like the set design and the costumes in this story. I think they suit what Terrence Dix was going for really well.
The production is really well put together. And also, I gotta say, I love the ending with Leela going temporarily blind. I love that scene with the doctor at the end.
And it's such a nice scene. It's a scene that you like. It doesn't need to be there.
It doesn't.
It's only there because Louise Jameson didn't like wearing the contacts, which, you know, I honestly can't fault her for that. Contacts are hard to deal with, but she's just so good in the role here.
And also, it's a lovely moment between her and the doctor, and I think a big breakthrough moment for the two of them as far as character development goes, and their relationship. It's a nice moment between the two of them, and just a brilliant way to bookend the story. It's not the best work. It's not the most captivating for me. Though I will also say it was my first Terrence Dix story that I ever watched, and I will always cherish that memory. I've become a bit more critical of the story as a whole over time, but yeah, I think it's fantastic.
I remember when I first said that I had issues with it, you were like, you had a massive rage boner against me.
Well, I mean, I still strongly disagree with you.
But, well, right, but I remember it was like a very angry passion.
Disagree. It was, Brian, I don't get angry, passionate, disagree.
That's not true at all. Disagree with opinions. That is not true.
Really don't.
Well, maybe you actually don't, but you've exaggerated in the past.
Well, yeah, I exaggerate, but come on, it's only when we're recording for shit.
Anyway.
All right, so I guess that about does it for that. Ratings out of 10 for Horror of Fang Rock, Brian.
6.
All right, Jacob.
10.
Wow. I'm going to give it a 7, personally. I think it's good. All right, and let us move on to our final story that, oh my god, I don't know how many times I've talked about this thing on channels before. I've talked about this story so many times.
Do you remember the time that we quote-unquote talked about it?
When we talked about the empty child of the doctor dances?
Yeah, the one where we just happened to mention it for a brief moment.
Yeah, well, no, we tried staying on topic at first. That didn't work out.
Okay, so let's see if we can do better this time.
Once again, I'll start. Also, I can start with the atmosphere. Is really also a good gothic atmosphere, which. It's interesting, considering it's set in World War II. Like, you don't really associate sort of a gothic tone with World War II.
Yeah, yeah. It is a nice contrast, because you do have, like, you do have a major World War II event happening above them, the London Blitz. Yet, the story is still very gothic and very set in its dark tone.
I'd also say honestly, this is a story where Stephen Moffat proves how good of a writer he can be on his first script for Doctor Who.
Definitely.
I love just this. It's a good example of how to actually subvert expectations. Because in subverting expectations can be very difficult to pull off properly.
I don't know what you mean when you say that the story subverts expectations.
You expect the villain not just how you expect, like you don't really see the twist that the child is just this poor kid who got caught in the bombs. You think maybe he's like some sort of alien taking on what he thinks a human form is, and like the real big twist of the child. That like Nancy and Jamie, they weren't siblings; they're mother and son.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay, I can see that now.
It's a big twist. that couldn't have happened in the classic series due to the time of the classic series.
Yeah, and it takes a very classical approach to this, to its storytelling. First off, being one of the first two-part stories, and basically being the length of a classic Who four-parter, and its general style makes it being one of the being the very first horror story in New Who, it takes that style of Hinchcliffe era gothic storytelling and modernizes it with things like the character of Jack Harkness and with the mother having a secret child storyline, which you would never get. Maybe in McCoy era you might get that mother
story. Maybe. And even then it would probably only be understated. Like, can we talk about in 2005, I don't want to say it's a risk of including a character like Jack as a companion, but it was kind of a big risk.
I don't think it was a risk, but I do think that it was bold.
It was a bold choice, and I think it was a correct choice to make. And I feel like it probably would have happened sooner. Because it happened in the Virgin New Adventures. You had companions. You had a companion who was at least bisexual with Chris Quedge.
I gotta just say, I've never heard his last name pronounced out loud before because I haven't heard him in any audio.
Yeah, no, his last name is Quedge.
Thank you for doing that.
Quedge. They make a joke. Gotcha. There's a joke about it in an original song where it's like, it should be pronounced Shvay, but no one pronounces it that way, so I go by Quedge.
Gotcha. Sorry, I keep yawning throughout this. I apologize. I've been for a while.
Anyway. Yeah, but I think John Barrowman
he's lovely. He totally sells the character. And actually, that transitions us into a thing I want to talk about, and that is performances, and specifically, of course, Christopher Eccleston,
who I had a thing to say about the story.
What? Go on.
Yes, Brain?
Okay, so I please don't call me that. Anyway, so I think Jacob really hit it on the head with a lot of the stuff he just talked about. Let me get that out of the way. But the other thing I wanted to talk about was that ending, though. Everybody Lives. It was like the only time that I will ever be like, okay, Moffat, that was a good move. I like that ending because at the time, you know, it was a genuine like, oh, that's nice.
Well, it works really well against the backdrop because you have such a desolate setting where people did die, like,
exactly,
on a nightly basis. So just this one night, everyone lived.
So as much as people moan and groan about it being telltale signs of what was to come, which, don't get me wrong, it is, I think within the context of this story specifically, it's actually a really nice way to end it.
Yeah, and also I think it does wonders for the Ninth Doctor's character arc in him finally having an adventure post-Time War where he does get to save everyone, and everyone does actually make it out alive. So I think that, and also you really say that in Eccleston's performance,
and like,
who
like the is the just thing lovely. Is the thing is Russell T makes sure to make that a point that this doesn't happen very often throughout the rest of his run as showrunner, which is really important because, like,
I don't remember what the next time is that happens. I guess maybe Silence in the Library, Forest of the Dead. Technically, no one dies in that.
For it to be like, you know, just a one-off thing that happens so rare that you. And Chris Eccleston just plays it so well, you know? It's nice. I like it.
Like, and I also think that, like, every story in Series 1, at least one person died in every single one. The Ninth Doctor just doesn't get a break.
He doesn't. Yeah. People die. Like, no villain really survived in Season 1.
Yeah, and even the villain in this isn't necessarily a villain. It's just
a kid looking for his mother.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's a not only just a lovingly gothic tale, but a very heartwarming tale at the same time. I think it accomplishes both very well. And
few nightmares that I had as little Brian, you know, like this was, you know, that stupid thing where kids hide behind the sofa. I'm ashamed to admit this, but little Brian did actually hide behind the couch for that one.
I mean, it's a creepy story. I'd also say Chris Eccleston's performance, like just before everybody lives, just before the story resolves, is the first time you see like this doctor really taking a gamble, because he's kind of like, shit, I don't know if this is gonna work, so we're gonna try this.
Yeah, it's nice. It's a very nice moment. I think the story as a whole is something that resonates with everyone, who, no matter what you're looking for in Doctor Who, or whether you're not looking for anything in Doctor Who, this could be your first episode, and you'll find something.
I often talk about stories I would introduce like new viewers to with each Doctor. It would probably be this story. Let's be honest.
I would
This works even better than Rose as an introduction for new audiences to the new show. It shows you like Rose's does a good job of like introducing you to like who the Doctor is and who Rose is as a character. It tells you all the characters are and what the format of the show is. But if you want a more general feel for what Doctor Who is like on any given day, or rather specifically on its best days, or what it should be like on its best days, this is a strong story to show people, because yeah, it just has a little bit of something for everyone.
Also, people veering slightly off topic, but because it has just popped into my head, and because I watched Girl in the Fireplace a few days ago, what is your guys' favorite pre Moffat era Moffat story?
Definitely this one.
I'm gonna say the scrub out and insert and go blink. I'm sorry.
See, I'm gonna go with Girl in the Fireplace. I really love that.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, huh. I think that's his weakest.
Really?
That's definitely his weakest, yeah.
Oh no, I really like that one a lot.
Like I mean Curse of Fatal Death I wouldn't compare to any of his New Who work, but I think Curse of Fatal Death is definitely, I as a whole, like, I would sooner watch Curse of Fatal Death to Girl in the Fireplace.
Really? See, yeah. I wouldn't.
I have a lot of fun with Curse of Fatal Death. Anyway, ratings out of 10 for The Empty Child and the Doctor Dances. I'll go first. I give it a 9. Brian?
I'll give it an 8.
All right, Jacob?
I'll give it a 9 as well.
There we are. Brian being the edgy contrarian, as always. Anyway.
Are we done? Are we able to not do any more videos tonight, please?
You know what,
attached to a wall in shackles for like 3 hours now. Can I leave?
What were you about to say, Jacob?
I know how I want you to introduce this one, right? With a little intro music from Dance Macabre.
Okay, gotcha. Anyway, next year, what do we think we could do? I think we should decide on it.
Image of the Venn doll.
You know what I want to do? We've done 2 years of television stories. I want to go completely off the rails and do expanded universe stories.
No.
No.
I want to talk Falls of the Shadow. Can we at least include Falls of the Shadow?
Look, I love Falls of the Shadow.
Please.
But no.
Please.
No.
Please.
No.
Please. Please.
No. Please. Oh. We're gonna do Image of the Fendall, Curse of Fenric, and Night Terrors.
Works.
We've already talked Night Terrors to death on this channel.
No, we haven't. I've never talked about Night Terrors before.
And I've only ever talked about Night Terrors once, a while ago.
Okay. Well, we at least have two.
What do you mean talk Night Terrors to death?
Then can we do like can we include a book?
No.
No. Oh no, we're gonna have Brian read Fear of the Dark to us the entire time.
I mean, I was gonna say, I mean, Brian could get a copy of Falls of the Shadow and read it.
No.
Shut up. Okay. All right. Tell us what your thoughts are on these spooky Doctor Who stories in the comments below. Do you agree with us? Do you disagree with us? Tell us what your thoughts are. What other spooky Doctor Who stories would you like to see us talk about in the future? I hope you enjoyed the second annual Doctor Who Halloween Spooktacular, and I will see you all in the next video. This has been Joey Morgan from Security Kitchen Productions. Goodbye. Hello and welcome to... Wait, how the fuck am I going to open this? Fuck. How should I open this?
You should do a spooky voice.
I'm not doing a spooky voice, Brian.
You need to be like, "Hello everyone, Joey Morgan here."
Here. We start with Toccata and Fugue in D minor. The do 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 do.
Fuck you.
Ba-da-da.
All right, I got it. No, I just didn't know what I was actually gonna say. All right, here we go. Ready?